I so appreciate being here and being able to speak to all of you. I live right down the road, so Patrick calls me up and has me come and speak to you guys. I focus a lot. I'm still doing trial work, but a lot of our work that I do that I focus on is at the U.S. Supreme Court. And I'm going to give you some details about First Amendment law and all of that, but I just want to, if you don't even remember anything more than we have freedom of speech rights, but I can't quite remember all the details, the more important thing that I want you to walk away with is how we need people to be courageous and to stand up in this kind of environment. Now, I think every decade or every generation of human history, wherever you live, are faced with unique challenges. And it wasn't like, you know, in the past, I lived through the Reagan days. They were, in some ways, the good old days. They were a lot better than the Jimmy Carter days. But it wasn't like some sort of American nirvana and that we've somehow bobbled the ball. That there were challenges that we had then. There was a lot of uncertainty. But the character quality that was needed was boldness and courage. And if I can offer you anything here is, we can't guarantee success, but Alliance Defending Freedom's got your back. We've got the expertise, we can come in. So when the YAF people out in Los Angeles and the Ben Shapiro thing, I wasn't directly involved in that case, but I'm good friends with a guy, with the ADF attorney who was, we were there to help you out. I went up about a year ago at Gettysburg College. The YAF chapter was just being challenged by a group of leftists on campus, and it was basically they were trying to shut them down, and they brought me in to speak on the importance of freedom of speech, and I felt like I was giving a lecture. And you know, if it had been mathematics, it was like 2 + 2 = 4. This was so self-evident, but I'm not in college every day, and it takes me, and it's like I'm glad for those kind of reminders of how hostile the environment can be to freedom of speech. I'm reminded of, let me just tell you one. So they were kind of yelling at me and condemning me, and they had pamphlets they handed out to me, you know, like condemning me personally and ADF and all this sort of stuff. And it was an effort to both stick true to principle, but also try to bring them in and to not just to fight them, but to say, look, I want to be on your side. It was also the first time I encountered calling somebody by the wrong pronoun and getting rebuked for doing that. And I'll tell you, this guy looked like a guy. So I don't know, maybe he was some gender queer guy that just has, you know, he's just like Mr. Potato Head with all of his pieces off or something. I don't know. But it was just weird. And even though I say that, I'll tell you, I'm involved in some of those cases, and you just think we're in crazy time, you know, and you think about this. I mean, I'm not quite sure what your political persuasions are, but I mean, like, you think like the bizarre set of people that we got that could be elected president, and then, you know, maybe ISIS will smuggle a bomb across the Mexican border and blow up Phoenix or you know, El Paso or something like that. I mean, there's all sorts of stuff. We need people of principle and people of boldness and courage. Now, one of the things, and I am going to get to the freedom of speech here in just a moment, but one of the things that I think is a very profound quote that Abraham Lincoln gave that you probably haven't heard before, on, and just to meditate on it, on like the truth of this, was one that he gave on December 3rd, 1861, in a message to Congress. So he had been elected 13 months earlier, and back then the inauguration was in March, you know, so you get elected in November instead of January 20th, that got changed by a later constitutional amendment. You were nominated, sworn in, not till March. And many of the states that entered the Confederacy had seceded by then, and so he was basically, there was nothing he could do about it because Buchanan was still president at that time. So then he comes in. More states secede. They have Fort Sumter. They've lost the battle, the first battle of Manassas right down the road here. And there was absolutely nothing positive that was going on for the Union cause. And so he wrote this in a message to Congress. The struggle of today is not altogether for today. It is for a vast future also. With a reliance on providence, all the more firm and earnest, let us proceed in the great task which events have devolved upon us. Now, what he's saying here is that he's trusting in the fact that there's something providential about the time in history that he's now in office. And so you can think that you're this age, you're college students, you weren't college students 200 years ago or 200 years in the future. We don't live in Bolivia or England or South Africa. We live here in the United States. And there is a certain set of circumstances that we find ourselves in, that the, how did he put it, the events that have devolved upon us. And one of the things that you're facing is not slavery or a dissolving union or something like that. What you're facing is an increasingly growing federal government, and you're at universities that are suppressing freedom of speech. And so what you have to realize then, Abraham Lincoln is counseling us, is that the fight that you fight is not altogether for what you're encountering today, but it is for the vast future. What concerns me the most about this is when you look at those videos from last year of, you know, at Yale, the shout down of the professors at the University of Missouri with the, you know, bring in the muscle lady, and I need some muscle here, lady, and all that kind of stuff. All the trigger warnings and you know, microaggressions and all that kind of stuff. We are training the next generation of leaders to think it is proper for the government to censor your speech for politically correct reasons, and that it is also a lawful constitutional goal of government to suppress speech that offends other people. I mean, to the point now where I just filed a case against a public school in Minnesota for there's a guy who says he's a girl trapped in a guy's body, and they're letting him go into the girls' locker rooms. And the girls were representing the girls who were saying, we just do not want to be dressing and undressing in front of a biological male who kind of does these, you know, kind of Miley Cyrus strip pole kind of things in the locker room with these girls, and he's definitely a biological male. And I'm concerned, like, what if they start saying you have to call this guy a woman, and you're going to get sanctioned by the court if I don't do that? I mean, that's the kind of stuff that we're facing more and more of, those types of things. Now, I don't know if that's going to happen. It may not at all. I don't know if we're going to win or lose. We haven't had our first court hearing yet. But that kind of stuff, you know, first time encountered it a year ago, Gettysburg. Now I might be seeing it in the courtroom. It's already in New York City schools, stuff like that. So for the things that I want to talk about, I want to talk to you about four mechanisms that that universities use to limit freedom of speech. And let me just start with one principle, that if you understand this about the Constitution, you'll be wiser and more knowledgeable than most people. And that is, only the government can violate the Constitution. So for those of you at private schools, if I forget to talk about it, which I will, you have a much smaller range of weapons you can use in private schools. And I'm going to talk about that. But public schools, public universities, the local community college that's run by the county or the city or whatever, those are all required to obey the First Amendment. And so these kind of mechanisms, you may see them in a private school, they have to be attacked a little bit differently. So what I'm going to address here are the common mechanisms used to repress speech at universities, and how the First Amendment basically prohibits them at public universities. Okay, and they are, the things I'm going to talk about here are speech codes, speech zones, non-discrimination policies for your groups, and restrictions on student fees that are given to groups to fund your activities. So speech codes, speech zones, non-discrimination policies for your club membership, and then the mandatory student fees. And all of this, let me just start off by saying, there is no right under the Constitution not to be offended. Now you may think, you mean like that may seem sort of intuitively true, but at many universities, this is like a big shockaroo for them to understand this, that they have no constitutional right not to be offended. Now, this was a common argument that has been raised before the Supreme Court for probably the last century. And the Supreme Court has absolutely and utterly rejected a right not to be offended. I can silence this person because that person is offending me. I have a right to stroll through the campus at the University of Babylon. And that was a joke. There really isn't a University of Babylon, but you get the idea. And it's a state university. I'm allowed to stroll down through a sanitized corridor where I never hear anything that offends me. That is total baloney. That is not, there is nothing in the First Amendment that supports that. In fact, it clearly opposes it. Here, of the many examples I could give, I pick at random a 1949 U.S. Supreme Court decision called Terminello versus Chicago. Accordingly, a function of freedom of speech under our system of government is to invite dispute. It may indeed best serve its high purpose when it induces a condition of unrest, creates dissatisfaction with conditions as they are, or even stirs people to anger. Speech is often provocative and challenging. It may strike at prejudices and preconceptions and have profound unsettling effects as it presses for acceptance of an idea. Now, this is so strongly still held by the justices of the Supreme Court, right or left, that the Supreme Court just a few years ago ruled 8-1 that the Westboro Baptist Church, with all of its hateful speech, could picket a funeral for a soldier who was killed in combat in, I can't remember if it was Iraq or Afghanistan, and they have some sort of weird warp view theologically that this is God's judgment on the United States for its acceptance of homosexuality, that soldiers get killed. And that's what all their signs were saying. And the Supreme Court said, as offensive as that is protected. Now, is this, now this is a recent Supreme Court decision, and I forgot to write down the year of it, it's the last 5 years. Can you imagine if Westboro Baptist at the average liberal, you know, granola college or, you know, private college or University of Babylon State, you know, that kind of thing, walked around with the kind of those signs? They people would not, there would be very few people saying, wait, even though their ideas are offensive, they're protected speech under the First Amendment. I think that would be an alien notion to many of the people who are students and going to be tomorrow's leaders. And that causes me great, great concern. Now, speech codes, this is regulated. The way that this offensive speech is regulated, first let's talk about speech codes. Now, these are codes that basically, sometimes they're harassment codes, but they're basically, many times, they say you have to be civil to other people. These are examples of ones that have been struck down as unconstitutional at San Francisco State. Students are expected to be civil to one another. Now, let me just say that, explain this to you. This is not like some sort of Hallmark greeting card policy that they had at San Francisco State. Hey, all you students, you got to be civil to each other. I mean, that's a nice thing, and they could say that. This was a policy that they enforced against the college Republicans when they were protesting terrorism out in Malcolm X Square at San Francisco State. And to do a little bit of street theater, they threw a flag of the Hamas terrorist group on the ground, and then they kind of went around in a circle like sometimes you see the Mideastern guys do, you know, stamping on it. What they did not realize, it had Arabic script on it and it had a passage from the Quran. And so the Muslim Student Union filed a complaint, and the school agreed with them that this violated the policy that students are expected to be civil with one another. And the college Republicans were hauled up on some sort of administrative charge for this. They contacted ADF, and we were able to get this policy declared unconstitutional. Some other ones. One of my favorite speech codes is from Penn State that says, intolerance will not be tolerated at Penn State. I think that'd be a great discussion at, you know, your the first discussion group at Philosophy 101, how a policy intolerance would not be tolerated at Penn State. But anyway, that's just a little joke there on that. But moving on. Okay, so they're usually stated with you have to be civil, you have to be nice, and they're usually done as well where third parties evaluate. So it's not like you say something that's objectively, there's some sort of objective standard that you're not being civil. Now, it would be protected to say, you know, everybody who opposes my belief should die. That would be a protected statement. But there would at least be some sort of objective argument that that's offensive or it's a threat or something like that. Now, when it's just generalized like that, the Supreme Court has said it has to be much more specific and directed at immediate lawlessness and not just some sort of general statement like that. But these policies usually go far beyond that and say that if people are offended, that the whether it's not civil, whether it's offensive, is in the ear of the beholder, not in whether it's offensive by some objective standard, which would have its own First Amendment difficulties. I want to be clear that that would still be unconstitutional. So if you say something like, I think Donald Trump should be elected president, I think marriage is one man and one woman only, I believe that Jesus Christ is the only Savior God has given for mankind to save us from our sins, you can say that in the nicest way. And if somebody says, oh, I perceive offense and threat and, you know, microaggression and or whatever, that's a violation of the policy. That is all totally unconstitutional. So if you encounter that at a public university, those are unconstitutional. Another problem that we have, so we have speech codes, are speech zones. And what they do is they'll basically say something like, this area on campus that is about three times larger than the podium here, that's the only place where we do freedom of speech here at the University of Babylon. And so if you're going to hand out copies of the Constitution or, you know, vote for Trump or something like that, you have to stand in this area when it's open. And it might be, we had a case at Yuba City Community College where their free speech, there was a Christian evangelical guy who was handing out gospel tracts, and they arrested him and ticketed him because free speech was only in one zone on campus that was about three times bigger than this podium, from I think it was 12 to 1 on Tuesdays and Thursdays. And we got a great picture of him, if I had a PowerPoint, of the policeman writing the ticket to this guy with his, you know, you must be saved, you know, sign that he's holding. And I mean, it was just laughably unconstitutional. School wouldn't back down. We sued them. The judge said, you got to be kidding me, school, and declared the policy unconstitutional. We had a case we recently won at North Carolina State where it was so overbroad that it was, if you were in the student union, And I realize that people don't usually do it this way, but you'll get the idea. If you said, hey, new person I just met, here's my business card. You know, give me a call or write me an email. And my email address is on the, you know, the information's on my card. That would be a violation of the policy. a one-on-one handing of a business card. It was just super overbroad, but that's what the policy said. So if they say things like, you can only hand out things in this certain area, and the area is usually in the campus equivalent of Outer Mongolia, you know, the dark side of the moon where nobody goes. And then frequently, this is also matched with, it would be one thing, it would still be unconstitutional if they did it across the board. But usually what they do is they say, oh, you're pro-lifers, you're pro-Trump, you go to the dark side of the moon. Oh, you're, you know, against Trump, you're whatever leftist cause is going on now. You know, you can just march unhindered in waves through the main part of campus, even though that's not, you're not supposed to do that, that's okay. And so they're ideologically really inconsistent. If they begin to bring an ideology into it and say, and basically the disfavored voices get the dark side of the moon areas, the lefty groups get, and their viewpoints get free run of the campus whenever they want, that is a violation of the First Amendment because it's based upon your viewpoint. And the Supreme Court has said that's the supreme no-no under the First Amendment of the government misusing it. So again, the government is bound by the freedom of speech clause, and that's how they violate it, by saying offensive speech, or depending on what you say, whether they like it or not, those are all unconstitutional. You know what is also really funny about this to me? I'll be in these debates, and I'm thinking, you know, I work for Alliance Defending Freedom. I'm an evangelical Christian. I'm condemned as this right-wing fundamentalist guy, all this sort of stuff. And I feel that my whole 32 years of litigating these kinds of cases has shown me to be a civil libertarian, tolerant of groups of views that I totally disagree with, protecting of minority rights to be able to assert themselves, et cetera, et cetera. And the hipster, groovster types that are, you know, drinking fair trade coffee and you know, wearing, you know, sandals made out of recycled tires and stuff like this, are the most authoritarian, fundamentalist, hypersensitive, I can't, you know, you're doing, you know, you're eating meat or whatever, you know, that kind of thing. You talked about a gun, you know, this kind of thing. And I just feel like they're in total denial of how they've become themselves the kind of fundamentalist that they supposedly abhor. So anyway, and I feel like, look, you let me run, be a federal judge, you think I'm gonna like bring in Sharia law, you know, some Christian version of Sharia law, or bring in the First Amendment? I think you'd be very surprised about how my colleagues and I would govern. You guys, I think that would be more like Sharia court, the liberal version of Sharia court, the way that you would ignore personal rights. But anyway, I'm kind of getting off the topic there, but you get the idea. Okay, so we talked about speech codes, speech zones. Then I want to talk about student fee funding. And let me just give you a little quick history on student fees. And let me check my time here because I'm going off on tangents and when I'm ranting and raving. And these YAF meetings just bring out that in me, which maybe I hope is more interesting to listen to. So I've argued one case at the U.S. Supreme Court, and it was a student fee case, which I'll get to in a moment. But I had to do a lot of research on the history of student fees. So back like, and I'm not even sure how long ago this, at least 100 years, maybe even 150 years ago, students began at, they would be going to some university and they'd say, hey, let's, you know, we don't have athletic fields here. Or the university, when we graduate, doesn't pay for our graduation gowns. So let's come together and vote to impose a fee on all the students to pay for a student union, a sports field, or get graduation gowns. And up until probably the 1960s, mandatory student fees were basically viewed as sort of this benign extra cost that wasn't too burdensome, that paid for basically these non-controversial additions that that kind of enhanced life at a university. So in the 1960s, during the Vietnam War era, Ralph Nader's was a big, he's still around, and a big activist at that time. He organized a group which you probably are familiar with the PIRG groups, and the Public Interest Research Groups. And so Minnesota PIRG will be Min PIRG, and they had WIS PIRG for Wisconsin PIRG. And they basically went and took over the student governments in the elections and then started voting student fees to go to basically left-wing activist groups. And it became kind of this, a lot of people, if you were from some, I'm going to be gross stereotypes here, but, if you're from some rural area and you're going to the ag, getting into the ag college, the lefty Naderite said, well, we can just impose a student fee and that student isn't going to object. They're just going to pay it because they want to graduate and go be a good farmer or whatever, that kind of thing. And so then it began to be this kind of corrupt system that would basically force students. They would put in rules like you can't graduate unless you pay the student fee, because when people start saying, wait, I don't agree with all these left-wing groups, why am I being forced to, back when I was arguing the Supreme Court, it's like a couple $100, it's probably a lot more than that now, to fund all these groups that I totally disagree with their environmental views, their views on marriage and sexuality, they would have pro-lifers being forced to fund pro-abortion groups, et cetera, et cetera. So they begin to impose rules. You cannot graduate if you refuse to pay the fee. You cannot transfer to another school and get your transfer materials, like your transcript, unless you pay the student fees. So it became this very, very coercive thing. So then I got contacted in, I believe it was 1995 or 1996, by a student named Scott Southworth, who was a law student at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. And he said, we object to this fee, and we've been seeing these cases where the labor union people, the people that object to labor unions, get to opt out of paying the fee. Can we try that? And I said, what a great idea. I've never even thought of that. And then he showed me all the groups that was just very offensive that they had to fund. So we filed this lawsuit, and we won at the federal district court, yay! Then the University of Wisconsin appealed it, we won there, yay! And then they appealed it to the U.S. Supreme Court, and we got this kind of half-baked, half-win, half-loss case. Although it's turned out to be more helpful, but it was disappointing the morning it came out. And the Supreme Court basically said this. And it was basically unanimous. A public university can require student fees, that all students pay it, but they have to ensure there is no ideological discrimination in how the money is handed out. And it's got to be handed out in fair ways. And that has been the battle since then. And they've tried to skitter in, we can't pay for the religious groups. We've been able to bat that down, because that violates the Establishment Clause. But one of the things that we keep seeing is that many university officials do not realize that they are government actors that have to obey the First Amendment. They view themselves as kind of these ascended education masters that are like helping to train the next Padawan warriors in the ways of the liberal force and all this sort of stuff, and they'll just start imposing things on groups. And so we've seen things like, you don't get student fees because you're not presenting both sides at your meetings, always done to conservative, pro-life, free enterprise, et cetera, groups, never on the lefty groups. That is totally unconstitutional. Or they'll have policies that say no political or no religious groups can get funded. both totally unconstitutional. And then they manipulate the definition of political and religious, that they'll say, there was a big case from the University of Wisconsin with student fees, and they would say, they refused to fund a evangelical Christian newspaper. They had a special fund to fund newspapers, but they funded the Jewish and the Muslim ones that were just very religious. And they said, well, those are ethnic, and the only thing that's religious is the evangelical Christian one. So they would just manipulate these categories like that. One of the other things that you would see is the restrictions on controversial speakers or speakers that are going to cause the controversy is going to cause security concerns. So let me give you a couple examples of that. The YAF chapter at Virginia Tech several years ago brought in Bay Buchanan, Pat Buchanan's sister, to discuss immigration policy, and she has views similar to Donald Trump. And the morning after the event, Virginia Tech said basically, we're not going to give you money for that. Even though we said this and that you spent all this money, and usually you get reimbursed for student fees. You have to spend the money and then get reimbursed. They said, we will not reimburse you because Bay Buchanan was too controversial, and therefore what you did, YAF chapter at Virginia Tech, was violate the principles of the community, whatever that means. And they said that it went too far, and they pointed to a poster that had advertised alien invasion, how illegal immigration is hurting America. And they said, that's too controversial. So a lot of public pressure. I don't think we had to file a lawsuit, but we did get involved. They reallocated, they restored the funding to YAF. We had another situation where Star Parker was brought to Texas A&M to discuss race and social justice issues from a pro-life perspective, and they were denied because they said, this is political. Now, there might be, just to be clear on this, that there possibly could be, but one of these cases that I'm about to describe, hypothetically, has never come up. There are separate laws in most states regulating donations for political campaigns. And so the concern here is that they're somehow funding a campaign by giving student fees for somebody that's too political. I think that there might possibly be a legitimate argument that a university or a state government might have. But those cases have never come up. Because what they'll do is they'll say things like this, that, you know, Bay Buchanan talking against immigration, or Star Parker, at Texas A&M talking about race and social justice, are political. So they make political to be this really elastic concept and not narrowly defined as funding a campaign event for a specific candidate to be, oh, that's kind of like political, talking about current events. So that's political. But then now you know that if it's Black Lives Matter, something like that, raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour, that's social justice, that's not politics. And so these categories, which they're not allowed under the First Amendment to use, can become very elastic and very viewpoint discriminatory in the way that they're applied. And so that's why we bring lawsuits to slap them down. Let me just end up then. So we're talking about speech codes, speech zones, the student fees. And again, let me just say, if you have any questions about this, call 1-800-TEL-ADF. You don't have to ask for me. We have university trained. You might get me, but we have a lot of attorneys. We have about 50 or 60 attorneys at ADF, and they got ones that just all they do is sit like monks studying this stuff and then litigating the cases, and they'll be able to give you advice on what's happening with all of this. Then I also want to talk about freedom of association. And these non-discrimination policies that are used to, oh, and you know what? I just realized something. Before I go into that, I forgot to say this on the student fees, about security fees. If they say, this is, okay, so they can say, there with the controversy thing, there's two ways that they can misuse this. And I realize I told one and not the other. The one that I said was they say, you're too controversial or you're political, so we're going to yank all your money. The other thing they can do is they can say, you have to pay extra money, maybe beyond what your student fee grant was, because you are a security risk. We expect all sorts of violence or whatever, or, you know, all that kind of stuff. We're going to have to bring out more police. So you have to pay like an extra, you know, $5,000 or $10,000. And then that's the way. So it becomes, in essence, a controversial attacks on controversial speech. And then, wow, your opponents, if they get wind of this, if they say, we're going to riot if, you know, this speaker is allowed on campus, you can shut that person down because of these security concerns. I can't remember what the Ben Shapiro thing, if it was a security fee thing, but they wanted to have his thing be where he was like in a balanced discussion. That's another trick they might do. So if they say you have to pay extra or you have to have a balanced presentation, you have to bring the other side, those are all unconstitutional. That they cannot do that. And there's specific court cases that say that. So I just want to just make sure that I say that. The other thing, which you may or may not run into, is the non-discrimination policies being used, in essence, to allow people that disagree with you to come to join your group. Now, these usually come in two versions. One of them is that they, what's called an all-comers policy, that every group on campus has to allow everybody to join. And that to me is just, and I mean the history of that, how that came about, it was more of a dodge that a California state university used to avoid some litigation. But now schools are actually adopting this. So it means that, you know, the campus libertarians have to allow socialists to join if you have one of these all-comers policies. What we're finding, though, is, now I think it's a direct threat to a right of association, but the courts have not bought that yet. But what we're thinking at ADF is that these cannot be enforced consistently. So we have seen in cases, and we just had trouble getting courts to buy this, where like there'll be some gay group that say, you must agree with the objectives of our group in order to join, and that's acceptable under an all-comers policy. Well, how in the world can that be? So that if they're really going to enforce this, they have to allow, you know, lumberjacks to join the environmentalist club. They have to allow deer hunters to join the, you know, the vegan society. And I mean, it gets to be, you know, like, do they have to allow dumb people to join Phi Beta Kappa? You know, like what, and they begin in the, you know, because it sounds very wonderful and grandiose. We're just going to let everybody join every club. Really? You know, and then some of those examples you start spinning out really don't work. So we think the inconsistent enforcement, that it's really an impossible policy to implement consistently across the board, will bring that down. The other one where we're seeing this is with religious groups, where they will say that a religious group that requires, so like if Hillel says, the guy who leads our Torah studies has to be a Jewish rabbi. To me, that's religious liberty. Under some of these policies, that's religious discrimination because they will not allow a Buddhist or an atheist teach the Torah. And there have been, where there's just been a lot of cat and mouse with this going on. Now you might say, well, YAF isn't a religious group, so we don't really have to worry about this. There are some schools that will say you cannot, they'll start off with, you know, race, religion, sex, and they just begin to add all sorts of weird things. And so they will add things like political party affiliation or political philosophy. There's some other ones like that that are not just leaping to mind. I forgot to write them in my notes. So that basically You cannot have an ideologically distinct organization on campus. And even if they had an all-comers policy or they were enforcing a policy that said you can't discriminate on the basis of political philosophy, both of those I think we would be very interested in challenging in court. I'm going to leave some time for Q&A, but I want to just say a couple of things. If you begin to develop things like this, call up ADF, we'll give you advice. Generally, if you're having difficulties with administrators, try to do it in email so that you have the written responses are preserved forever, everything's preserved forever on the internet. Or if you have to talk in person, bring other people with you so you have witnesses who can say, yeah, he really did say that we don't want people who believe the way you do speaking on campus or something like that. You wouldn't have other witnesses to that sort of thing. And then we do not urge people to get arrested. It may feel good, but it doesn't help the case generally. But what we do need are people to be courageous. And I don't think, this is the one thing that I would say too. I don't think there's a difference between being obnoxious and being kind of prophetic and that sort of thing. And I just don't like obnoxious. Maybe it's just a personal, so this isn't the constitutional law lawyer talking here. But I do like people that are courageously pushing the envelope and raising things like that cause the other side to stutter. So, like to talk about Black Lives Matter. See, this would be the kind of debate that I think that would throw the other side into conniption fits. The title of the debate would be, is it white privilege or is it marriage privilege? How marriage between one man and one woman brings, you know, economic security, emotional stability and stuff, and you know, that sort of thing. And then basically get them to talk about, well, look, if you got 80% of African American children being born out of wedlock, how do we determine how much of the negative effects is racism and how much of it is the fact that they're abandoning the marriage privilege that anybody, whatever their race, can partake of? Now, to me, that's like, you kind of see like their gears grinding in their brain. Like, how do they deal with that? But you're kind of acknowledging, there's racism, but what about the marriage issue, which they're in denial of? Like, whatever you want sexually, that's okay, and it has absolutely no consequences. Oh, really? Well, let's look at the facts. See, that to me is being provocative and bold and that sort of thing. Now, let me just say one thing directly too. Wow, I've encountered a speech code or a speech zone or one of the, you know, they're discriminating the way they hand out, on ideology, the way they hand out the student fees. ADF has called me up. I've talked to them and they said, we want to file a lawsuit for free on your behalf. And then you have this thought. Will I ever graduate from college? What will my grade transcript? I'll flunk every class. Everyone will hate me. And, oh wait, no, that's too scary. If you're a Christian, I get this. I'll be a bad witness if I do that. I can't do that. And I just want to say to you, it's not like you should always volunteer to be a plaintiff, but I think you need to think about those words that Abraham Lincoln was talking about, is that whether you are fighting just for the day or for the vast future, and that there needs to be somebody to stand up. Because there's not, whenever you stand up, there is always risk. Now, I realize it's easy for me to say. I have to admit, I have 3 kids in college right now. I have 7 children. I think 3 of them are in college right now. If they came and said, Dad, I want to be a plaintiff in a lawsuit against, you know, George Mason University, I'd go, wait! I mean, I know, I understand that. That'd be my first reaction. Then I kind of calm down, listen to the situation, and say, look, sometimes there's a time for courage. And I want to just finish with this, and then we'll take some Q&A. President Teddy Roosevelt's words in 1910 at the Sorbonne, which is this passage I'm about to read. You sometimes will see it like on, you know, posters or whatever, called The Man in the Arena. And this I just think this is, so we start with Abraham Lincoln saying, you know, we're fighting for today and for the vast future. This puts the kind of the same idea in a different way that says we need people who are courageous and willing to take risks in the situations that they are encountering today. So Teddy Roosevelt said this: "It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could not have done better. No, the credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs and comes up short again and again, because there is no effort without error or shortcoming. But this person knows the great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself for a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least he fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who knew neither victory nor defeat. Amen, Teddy Roosevelt." And I'll tell you, I have experienced this in courtrooms where we lose, where we win, we have the high exhilaration of victory. And even when we lose, we have this enduring sense of satisfaction and dignity that we tried to do something, and even though we failed, we tried it. Now, you don't have to all become lawyers and just be litigators. You have opportunities on your campus. The YAF people at Gettysburg who brought me in, I think I respect them as people of great courage to bring in somebody to take them on. And we helped diffuse a situation there. I mean, I don't know what's been happening this year. Maybe it's burning again up there. But that's the kind of courage you can show even without a law degree or the ability to go to court or whatever. But courage, perseverance, being able to take the risk, that's what's going to, at the end of your life, you'll look back and say, I really lived for something, and I am proud of how I expended my life and my opportunities. Thank you very much. Okay, I think we're supposed to be done at 8. In fact, any of the staff people here, anyone wave to me, is that correct? So, okay, so I'm not like, you're not like, okay. I wanted to make sure you weren't groaning that I was running way over or whatever. Okay, questions, anyone? Do we have mics for them, or how are we going to do this? Okay, we're going to get the mic squad here. Oh, I see you line up with mics. Okay, yes.
Hi, thank you so much for coming to speak. I really enjoyed what you had to share, and I loved your quote by Abraham Lincoln in the beginning. My question for you is, you touched on it briefly about the transgender issue going on right now, and I know that there are some lawsuits happening right now in the States, but I'm not exactly even sure, and I know that many of us as conservative students know that what's going on with the transgender bathrooms is wrong, but how do you go about fighting that legally? What steps do you take? What's happening right now? That's not the same as fighting free speech zones, I know, but...
Can I speak till 9 o'clock? No, that was... Okay, let me give you the... The ADF has a website, I know, like our marketing people do, and I have to admit, I haven't paid total attention to it. But this is legally what they're doing is, and then I'll give you just some thoughts on how to respond to it that you can take home rather than give you, and I'll tell you, I'm still learning on this.
Okay.
But what they're doing is they're basically saying that sex is not an objective category, that male and female are not objective categories, but it's gender identity, it's what you think in your head, is what you think in your head is what's right. Now, the problems with that I would bring up in those kinds of environments is, what does this make of, I mean, this is kind of an odd phrase, but traditional feminism. So, if you accept the fact that men treat women poorly, they underpay them, they don't value their opinion, and stuff like that, so therefore we need to rectify these by laws and change attitudes and, you know, that sort of thing. Let's pass Title IX so that women have equal activity, equal opportunity at public campuses. Well, this case that I just filed in Minnesota, so that's the whole thing. When the sports teams, this guy is coming in, girls are quitting the sports teams because they don't want to undress in front of a biological male. And then they're saying to them, your desire to undress privately is a bigoted thing. And I said, why? See, and to me, you know, I haven't even formulated all the things. It basically, you make the whole concept of feminism then to me rather than kind of a clear goal, it becomes kind of this unsettled goal, if not invalid, because you can't, and so I have to go into court and say, these women are being oppressed, they're being denied equal opportunity under Title IX, and their response is, they just gotta get over their hangups, because if a guy says he's a girl, then he's a girl, and he can come up and in this case, he's asking them their bra size. That's normal girl talk. And the fact that he's a biological, they just have to view him as a guy, because this was said in one of the court hearings that ADF is doing, is that there's no body part that you can, this was a federal Justice Department lawyer said this in court a couple of days ago in Ohio. There is no body part that's intrinsically male or female. And you think like, okay, we're in Crazyville. Okay, so this is, I mean, like, these are some of the things I think of as saying. Is if Jimmy Carter, if Hillary Clinton gets elected president, and Jimmy Carter says, I'm really a woman trapped in a guy's body, is she the second woman president or the first woman president? If the day before she gets inaugurated, Hillary Clinton says, I'm really a man, and then she gets sworn in, are we still waiting for our first woman president? Is President Obama's fatherhood initiative, you go and look, one of the most lucid intervals that Barack Obama has had is his fatherhood initiative, and you can Google this and look, he's got the White House website, and he talks about how the fact that his father left him when he was younger was traumatic and you know, hindered him and held him back and stuff like this, and that he doesn't want any other children to suffer that way. So is his whole fatherhood initiative invalid? And then this is the other thing, is there's two ways of talking about gender identity, how the other side talks about it, in a way that is totally contradictory. And it's this, there's male and female, there's a binary, but sometimes the female essence gets put in a male body. And so when the guy says, oh, I'm really a girl trapped in a guy's body, then we kind of move him back over, but there's still essentially this binary thing, and we're just, you know, kind of swapping around the people that are mistaken. Okay, so that's one. But then the other one is that it's all arbitrary and made up. Like the genderqueer people say, we're just all Mr. Potato Head. And you just kind of choose what things to slap on you. And I'm probably, and if people were actually believing that, I would be probably nicer to say that. But you can't have those two concepts cannot coexist. You can't have the binary is really true, but sometimes people get put in the wrong bodies versus everybody is free to do whatever they want. This is one of the problems when they say the guy who thinks he's a girl can go in the girl's locker room. Where does the genderqueer person go? Do they get to choose every day they come? But if they identify as neither male nor female, then what's going on here? The other problem, and I do not say, and we do not say that they're predators, but how about invalid, insincere declarations of gender identity? So if a guy says, hey, you mean I can go into the locker room of naked girls if I say I'm a girl trapped in a guy's body? Now, that would be a very bad thing. And the people who believe in transgenderism say, well, that would be bad and all that. But they cannot come up with a mechanism to separate the kind of the fake ones from the true ones. And then but if it's all self-identification, I don't know how they can even question it. The other thing that I would bring up, now this gets to be a little more provocative, but I'll just say this to you. There's a condition called apotemnophilia, which is connected to gender dysphoria. And I realize I've only gotten to one question here, but this you may find this. Apotemnophilia, this is an actual condition, is people who think they are handicapped people trapped in regular bodies. And they will go to doctors and say, will you amputate my leg because I believe I'm a paraplegic, but I have two normal legs. And the doctors will say, I'm not going to do that. So they'll do things like they'll take a shotgun and shoot their lower part of their leg so and be rushed to the emergency room, and they have to get amputated. There are also people that this is a true condition, and I'm not trying to mock anyone who deals with transgender issues, who think they are animals trapped in human bodies. The concept of werewolves came out of this. So if somebody says, I really feel I'm a dog or a wolf trapped in a human body, do you say, you need help? Or do you say, let's find you a kennel? I mean, I don't, you know what I mean? That it's that, and where this comes up seriously too, that there is a capacity for self-deception. If somebody says to you, let's say there's a 100-pound, 5'4" woman who says, I'm just so fat, and I've been engaging in anorexic and bulimic activities to get rid of my excess weight. Now, do we say, we challenge, now this is the normal treatment now, it's done gently and with respect, we challenge your self perception that you're too fat. We don't say, yeah, you are, let me pay for your liposuction. We don't do that. So I just think we're in a crazy time right now, and you cannot sustain a society on an ethic that says people can do whatever they want sexually. Okay, I went way over there. It's 8:00. I'm gonna look for Patrick or somebody. Should we cut this off? He's got more things. One more question. Okay, sorry, you got the big question. I'll be around for a while here too during break time. Yes, sir.
Hi, thank you so much for talking to us. It was very good to get all that information. My question relates to the case Texas v. Johnson, which relates flag burning to conduct as protected speech.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering what you thought of that analysis by the court. That was majorly a liberal decision with one notable exception, Justice Scalia. And then how far can conduct go as speech before you could feasibly make a university policy or a law against it?
I think you can have conduct that is expressive, that I think the decision was basically rightly decided. Now, if they wanted to burn down the campus, that's a different thing. If they want to shoot people to make a statement against white racism or white privilege, that would be a criminal offense. But the burning was just a symbolic thing. And now we're encountering this, I'll tell you, so we have a vested interest in this. When, the photographers and the florist and the cake bakers, they're being told, you're just a purveyor of goods and services, and there's no expression going on here. Excuse me. Then I try to remind them, flowers, poinsettias mean Christmas. During the Vietnam War, they would put flowers in the barrels of the guns when they would have the anti-war, the cake baker cases. Do you know the one in Colorado? They wanted rainbow batter. So they didn't want to feed the people with it. What they wanted was a prop for the time, the wedding ceremony, then there's the reception where they cut the cake, and then, the bride and the groom shove it into each other's mouth. They wanted to cut the cake, pull out the cake, rainbow batter, and then shove it into each other's mouth. Now, I don't think there's a person in America that could not say, if I said, what message is that communicating? It would not be, they're hungry, or something like that. It's that it is legitimate for same-sex couples to participate in this ritual that you do at a reception to show people are truly married. So I don't have any problems with Texas v. Johnson being wrongly decided. Okay, thank you, and back to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, students, so we're gonna break for nighttime. I don't know what else to say. We're done for the day, which is exciting. But tomorrow, I just have a few closing announcements, so please pay attention. Tomorrow, your shuttle is going to be leaving the hotel at approximately 8:30 in the morning. So please get up, have breakfast at the hotel restaurant, which is called Syrah, I believe. So that is located. So if you're at the front desk, if you're at the front check-in desk, there's a stair. There's a set of stairs that goes right up to the second level. That is where the restaurant is. You cannot get to it from the second floor if you just take the elevators from where your rooms are. There's two separate wings of the hotel. So you're going to want to go over to the front desk. Just walk over there, then walk up the stairs. You should have breakfast coupons in your room. And if you don't, just ask the front desk. They know you're with YAF. They should be able to provide you with one, so your breakfast is complimentary. So again, the shuttle is leaving at 8:30 in the morning, so make sure you're on it. If you are late, if you oversleep or anything like that, and you miss the shuttle, first call me to let me know you're going to be late. Text me, something like that, because you have my phone number. It was in the email. And then call Uber so you can get a ride over here. We want to make sure you get here on time. We have an exciting day tomorrow, starting off with Robert Spencer first thing in the morning. We do have a ton of leftover food, so if anybody is still hungry and wants to take some food with them back to the room, please do. We'd be happy to make you a plate to take home. Help yourself to coffee, soda, snacks, anything that you want to take back to your room. It's all fair game, so help yourself. And with that, the shuttles are downstairs waiting for you, so we look forward to seeing you tomorrow morning.